stuck in her throat like a piece of apple skin. When it was time for her to go to bed, she felt it was her last chance. He would be leaving for the hospital early the next morning after Uncle Crispin came to take her to Long Island, to Peconic Bay, where she was to stay with him and his wife, her Aunt B, for 2 weeks. Her father was resting in an armchair, a blanket across his knees, and an old wool scarf of her mother's around his shoulders. Even though it was the middle of June and so warm that Emma herself was wearing a thin cotton t-shirt, she stood close, but not so close she was crowding him. He couldn't bear that now, she knew. Someone saw her once or more. She asked me why I was so bow-legged. You're not bow-legged, her mother broke in. That's typical of B. She had a present for me, Emma went on, recalling her aunt vividly sitting in the very chair where her father was sitting now. Now she seemed as many clothes as most people wore, and how her huge gray eyes had so much white around the irises. They resembled the eyes of a big doll. She kept asking me why I didn't do exercises to correct my legs. I was wondering about the present she was holding. I thought she'd never give it up. I said I wasn't bow-legged, Mom. She sort of pushed the present at me. It was a box of watercolors. I don't recall any present, her mother said, looking at her father, whose head had fallen back against the chair. She went to him and put her hand very gently on his neck. She asked me if I knew how to mix colors to make other colors, Emma said. When I said I didn't, she said, ridiculous. Her parents weren't listening to her. She saw how slowly her father reached up to touch her mother's hand. Emma thought, we are all scared. Her laziness is a help, her father said. She used to make fun of me when I was a kid, but she'd suddenly get bored and go off somewhere and daydream. Just stay out of her way as much as you can. It isn't such a long time, her mother said, and I'll have to be away so much you'd be stuck with babysitters. I'm 10, Emma said with a touch of indignation. I could stay alone. I have stayed alone. Out there on Long Island you'll have a beach in the bay, her mother said. Emma, I'd be worried you here all day, and I'll be worried enough. She understood what he was asking of her, but she wanted to cry, to let him see tears run down her cheeks, to go to her room and slam the door, or at least to look gloomy and let her shoulders droop. She saw her suitcase near the front door, and next to it a shopping bag full of puzzles and books, and a diary she hardly ever wrote in. What I'd like, stared at her father. The little animal of fear inside her had grown very large. Her mother came to her side and stroked her hair. "I'll telephone you every evening," she said. "I'll call you too," her father said, "as soon as I can." Chapter 2 photographs I'm sorry he didn't go on with his career, but it is a hard life being a concert violinist. There are so many good musicians struggling to find work. I'm sure he's a fine teacher. Are you interested in music? Do you play? The recorder, she replied. Everybody in school has to learn to play. Good, he said, as though he really meant it. You'll find it an immense comfort as time goes on. I teach most of the year and give private lessons in the summer, but I try to play for myself every day. A life without music would hardly be a life. The idea that music could be a comfort was a new one for Emma. When her father played his violin at home in the small room off the kitchen, which was like a big closet, his forehead wrinkled, his mouth was shut tight, and he looked lost in a dream. Is it strange to have your father teaching in your own school? Do you have to take his class? He asked. He's the only music teacher, so I have to, she answered. She hadn't thought it strange. It was certainly difficult at times. The children teased her and said her father went to sleep and snored in some of his classes. It wasn't true, but she felt embarrassed just the same. Yet if she happened to pass his class and glimpse students looking at him with interest, she felt proud. Teachers' kids get scholarships, she said. That's why I go to the school. There were days when she wished she went to a school where she didn't know anyone, except a few other children, where teachers didn't give her a special smile when they passed her. It must be hard for you to think about anything but your father right now, Uncle Crispin said. My mother was very sick for a time when I was a boy. I remember I felt as if I was sitting on a little chair in a huge empty house. No people or cats or dogs, no books and furniture and pictures, and that I wouldn't be able to get up and move until she returned from hospital. But she did come back, Emma said, her heart suddenly pounding. Yes, she came back, he answered, and so will your father, I'm sure of that. I've been reading up on the operation. The doctors have it down pat these days. She didn't want to hear about the operation right now. She asked him quickly about his name. I never knew anyone called Crispin, she said. It's not too common, but you run across it every so often. St. Crispin was a Christian missionary in Gaul. He was martyred in 287. He was a shoemaker and is the patron saint of all shoemakers. When you come to read Shakespeare, his Henry V, you'll find Crispin there. This story shall the good man teach his son, and Crispian shall ne'er go by from this day to the ending of the world, but we in it shall be remembered, we few, we happy few, we band of brothers, for he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother. Emma was startled. He seemed for a moment to have become another person, his voice booming, one hand gesturing at the windshield, but when he spoke again, it was in the mild, slightly apologetic voice she was getting used to. We've exchanged rhymes, he said, smiling, so we shall be friends. What does martyred mean? Asked Emma, rather hoping he would burst into poetry again. To die for your faith, he replied. Left the gasolines and shopping malls behind them. Sparse woods of stunted pine trees grew beside the road. See how the sky has grown so vast, he said. It's because we are close to the sea. She had noticed the light changing, touching the dark green pines with a white gleam. crisp and stop the